Okay, we're going to talk about stationary points, but before we do that, we're going to do this warm-up here, talking about axis of symmetry. So axis of symmetry is the part that makes it symmetrical. That's why it's called a symmetry. So I want to find the equation of these vertical lines. Axis of symmetry is always going to be x equals a number. So here we notice it crosses the x-axis at 0 and 6. So halfway between 0 and 6 is x equals 3. So when you're writing the axis of symmetry, you always have to have x equals. I saw a number of students today just write 3. And I'm going to take a point off if I ask you for the axis of symmetry and you just write 3. It has to be x equals 3. Okay? So you can tell from this picture, halfway between here and here is negative 2.5. And halfway between negative 1 and 3 is going to be at x equals 2. Okay, now here my graph crosses the x-axis at 2 and at 6. So my parabola looks like something like that. So if you visually can't see it, to figure out the axis of symmetry, you can take the midpoint between those two. So to figure out the midpoint, I could do 2 plus 6 and divide it by 2, and that will give me the midpoint. And 2 plus 6 is 8. 8 divided by 2 is 4. So this line right here is at x equals 4. Okay, and here are the answers for B and C. I'm going to work out 3 just because it's a little bit tricky. Okay, quadratic function has an axis of symmetry equaling x equals negative 3, and one of the y-intercepts is 4. Find the other x-intercepts. So we know that we're going to have y equals, one of the x-intercepts is 4, so I would have x minus 4, and then this is x minus, I'm going to call it a. I don't know what else to call it. We want to find the other x-intercept. So we know the axis of symmetry is halfway between the two. So just like we did here, halfway between 4 and a. So we can do a plus 4. I want to find the midpoint between them, so I have to divide by 2, add them together and divide by 2. And we know that that will give us the axis of symmetry, and the axis of symmetry is negative 3. So now I could simplify this, multiply both sides of the equation by 2, and then I have a minus 4 equals negative 6, and then I add 4 on both sides, and I get a equals negative 2. Oops, a. Okay. Oh. Did I do something different? Oh, duh. It's plus. So we subtract 4 on both sides. We get a equals negative 10. Okay. Find the axis of symmetry for each function. Okay, so an alternative way to figure out the axis of symmetry is using the equation negative b over 2a. Okay, so in this example, a equals 1, because there's no number, so it's going to be a 1. B equals 6. Here we have a equals 1, b equals negative 8. Here we have a equals 2, b equals 5. Okay, so I simply use this formula, and I find the axis of symmetry. Okay. Check your answers. Okay, use the x-intercepts to find the axis of symmetry. Okay, this is just like the earlier ones. We know one of the x-intercepts is negative 2, one of the x-intercepts is 5. I can take the average between those two, and I get the x-intercepts. Now, this B question is very interesting. So, we know, we're going to show that both ways for finding axis of symmetry gets us this equation. So, we're going to write the function in this form and then evaluate this. So, we've got y equals x plus 2 times x minus 5. So I'm going to rewrite this in standard form. This is standard form. So to do that, I get x times x gets me x squared. X times negative 5 gets me negative 5x. 2 times x gives me plus 2x. And 2 times negative 5 is negative 10. Okay, combine the middle terms. I get y equals x squared minus 3x minus 10. So I know that a equals 1 and b equals negative 3. And we're going to use this formula here. So we have x equals negative 3 over 2a. And then so now I have my axis of symmetry is equal to 3 over 2. And you can see this axis of symmetry is the same as this one here. This one here, I just found the midpoint between negative 2 and 5. This one here, I use negative b over 2a. You use this method if it's in standard form. You use this method if you're in factored form. Okay. Now on to the math part. Okay, so stationary points are when we have a horizontal tangent. So here we have, like if I picked a point here, you know that we've got a increasing tangent line. Over here, we've got, just if I pick a random point, our slope is decreasing. Over here, our slope is increasing. And the places where we have a horizontal tangent is when the derivative, the slope, is zero. So as it says here, whenever the slope is zero, we're going to have either a maximum or a minimum point. So the point of this entire paper is we're going to make the derivative equal to zero, and then that'll help us figure out if we've got a maximum or a minimum point. Okay. Another thing that also happens when the derivative is zero is we can have an inflection point. Because if we look at this example, y equals x cubed, this entire part of the graph is increasing, and this part of the graph is also increasing. So we're always having our graph increasing. Okay, so, but we know the first derivative, we know the derivative is equal to zero when x is zero. So this is a stationary inflection point. Okay, so we either have local minimums, local maximums, and stationary inflection points when the derivative is zero. Okay, you may want to highlight it the same color as I do. When I have it increasing, I've been highlighting it red. When I have it decreasing, I've been highlighting it blue. So, now let's talk about example 7. Okay. So the very first thing I did for example 7. Okay. Find and classify all the stationary points. Okay, so first of all, we've just learned that to find the stationary points, I can find the derivative. Okay, and then when the derivative is equal to zero, that's when we know we have a stationary point, either a maximum or a minimum or an inflection point. So the first thing I'm going to do is factor out a 3, and I get this. And then I say, oh, what two things multiply to give me 3 and subtract to give me 2? And it's going to be x minus 3 times x plus 1. Okay, so I know, and I'm going to make the derivative equal to 0. So now I know that my my stationary points are at when x is 3 and when x is negative 1. Okay, so I can make a sine diagram like this. Now I'm going to talk about how I figured which one was positive and negative right now. Okay, so the first thing I did is I picked some random point somewhere between negative 1 and 3. Well, I just picked, oh no, sorry. I picked some number less than negative 1, like negative 2, for example. That works. So if I plug in negative 2 into this factored equation, that's the easiest to do, then I have 3 times negative 2 minus 3 times negative 2 plus 1. All I did was plug in negative 2 in for x in this part of my derivative function. So I have a positive times a negative times a negative. That's a positive times a negative gives me a positive. I actually don't care what value I get. I just need to know, is this positive or negative? So if it's positive, I put the plus here, and that means it's increasing. If the derivative value is positive, that means my function f of x is increasing. I'll say that again. If the derivative solution is positive, that means it's increasing. Just like here, increasing. Okay, let's put a number between negative 1 and 3. 0. So if I plug in 0 here, I have 3 times negative 3 times 1. That's a positive times a negative times a positive, which gives me a negative value. So this is going to be negative. And lastly, a number greater than 3, let's pick 4. So 3 times a positive gives me a positive. So at negative 1, we know it's going up, and then it's going down, right? If you go up till you get to a high point, and then you go down, you've climbed the top of a mountain. So that's going to be a maximum at negative 1. If you're going down and down and down, and then you start going up, you've reached the bottom of a valley. So that's going to be a minimum. So I'm going to go to my original function and plug in negative 1 into the original function, and then I get 10. So my local maximum, because it's going up and then down, my local maximum is negative 1 comma 10. Now I'm going to plug in 3 and into my original function, and then I get negative 22. So my local minimum is negative 22. You might want to hit pause to copy this down. Okay, next page. Okay, so let's talk about this. All right, so A is the top of the mountain, it's a local max. B is at the bottom of the valley, it's a local min. At O, we have an inflection point. Okay, so if I'm making a sine diagram, the most important thing is the stationary points, negative 2, 0, and 3. Okay, it's increasing, it's decreasing, it's increasing. So the red parts where it's increasing, I've highlighted in red. The decreasing parts, I've highlighted in blue. State the intervals where it's increasing. So it's increasing when x is less than negative 2, and it's also increasing when x is greater than 3. Okay, and it's decreasing when x is between negative 2 and 3. Now, question D was a little bit tricky. We hadn't seen one like this. This says, when is f of x, draw a sine diagram for f of x, not the derivative. This one's the derivative. This is the sine diagram for this thing. So basically, if I look at my function here, don't pay attention to the red and blue. When is the graph above the x-axis? And you can see on the picture, it's above the x-axis between negative 4 and 0. So between negative 4 and 0, it's above the x-axis. It's positive. We have a positive value. It's the function is also above the x-axis when it's greater than 5. over here it's below the x-axis, over here it's below the x-axis. So basically what they're saying is when you're drawing a sine diagram of the function f of x, when is it above the x-axis, when is it below? I'm not sure if we're going to see this example too much more. Mostly we're going to see this, the sine diagram of the derivative. It's going to be mostly this for this chapter. Okay, consider the graphs. How many stationary points? So we've got one minimum, another minimum, a maximum, and an inflection points. Those are my four stationary points. Okay, write down the coordinates of the local min, max. Okay, this should be self-explanatory. Let me know if you have a question on this part. Okay. All right. Use the quadratic formula to find the equation of the axis of symmetry. Okay. So here we know that A equals 2 and B equals negative 5. So I plugged it into negative B over 2A and we get 5 over 4. Now I could take the derivative of this. The derivative is going to give us 4x minus 5. And so using the derivative, hence find when the derivative is 0. So if I make the derivative equal to 0, we know we have a stationary point. So if I make the derivative equal to 0, I end up with 5 over 4. They're the same. Isn't the x value of a stationary point the same value as the axis of symmetry? I'll say that again. Isn't the stationary point of a quadratic give you the axis of symmetry also? Think about that. In fact, let's look at the earlier example. This point right here, if I take the derivative of this, we know the derivative is 0. That's going to give me the axis of symmetry. Okay, question 4. P, just from looking at the picture, you could tell it's a local max. Q, you can tell is a local min. Okay, we take the derivative of this function, we get this. Okay, if I factor this out, we know one of my zeros is positive 1, and one of my zeros is negative 5. Okay, so now to find Q, I plug positive 1 in, and I get this value. To find P, I plug in negative 5, and then I get this value. Should I zoom in? That might be helpful. Okay. The next example, 7, I'm going to just redo it so you can see the process of the thinking for this problem. Okay. All right. Okay, so the derivative of this is 9t squared plus 4t minus 4. Okay, so when I drew this to make my answer key, they want us to sketch both of these. Okay, so 3. Okay, so here is the derivative. Here is the original function. Now, I don't know if you know this trick, but notice if I arrow over here and if I hit enter, I can make it bold. And if I click enter again, it's not bold. If I hit graph, it's not going to show the derivative function because I didn't make it bold. Okay, so I changed the window so that it would go from negative 3 to 3, and so you can go to window, and I changed the window to match what was here. Okay. So one thing you can do is you can hit second graph to get a table, and that was this helped me get some points to plot my graph. Okay, so at negative 2, we're at negative 6. At negative 1, I'm at 5. At 0, I'm at 2. At 1, I'm at 3. And at 2, I'm at 26. Okay, way up. Okay. Now, let's look at this graph. Okay, so that looks something like... kind of hard to tell, but... looks something like that. Okay, if it's a close sketch, that's fine. On the test, you're going to have to draw a sketch, and these points are going to help you with making the sketch. Okay, now I'm going to color this pink because it's increasing. Now, we're going to have to do some special steps to figure out where actually the max is and the minimum is. So I'm going to hide this right now. And let's look at this one. So now I'm hit enter, and now we're going to get that graph. Okay. So they want you to draw this sketch now. So this value right here, notice here it's positive, and then it's negative, and then it's positive. So right where, this is a graph of the derivative. So when it changes from positive slope to negative slope, at that point directly below this stationary point is where the... the graph is going to be zero. And directly below this stationary point is where my derivative is going to be zero. Okay. Okay. So let's use some other colors here. So notice this orange part is positive, because the pink part of the graph is going up, it's increasing. This part here in green, notice that is negative, and that's because the blue part of the graph, the original function, is decreasing. Since the original function is decreasing, our derivative function is below the x-axis, it's a negative value. Okay, so you might want to hit pause to draw your graph. Okay, so to figure out the where this point is, you can hit second trace and zero. So second trace, and then 2 for zero, enter. And now I need to do the left bound, right bound thing. So see my little blinking X? Okay, now I'm to the left of this intersection, I hit enter. I need to go to the right of where my pen is pointing. I hit enter. It says guess, I hit enter again. And this intersection is negative 9.25, and that's what we have here. And I do the same thing for that process to get this x-intercept. And you can tell that this is going to be a maximum, and you can tell that this one's going to be a minimum. Okay, and given this restricted domain, these are the minimum and maximum. Okay. One way you could do this very quickly is if I do second graph to get a table, I can see, look, that's not right. Let's see why. Okay, that table was of the derivative. Enter. Here's the function. Enter. Second graph. Okay, so at negative 2, our value is negative 6. And if I go down to positive 2, my y value is at 26. Okay. You might want to replay a part of this to hear it again if you need help. Okay, question one, find the derivative. Okay, there's my derivative function. Question B, find the stationary point. We make the derivative equal to 0, and then I find out the stationary point happens when t is 1.93. Show that it's a maximum point. So I picked a point below 1.93. How about 1? I plug that into the derivative, and we get a positive value. Okay, I pick a number above 9.13. How about 3? If I plug 3 into my derivative function, I replace t with 3, we end up with a negative value. So the sine diagram shows that it's a maximum value. Okay. Okay. This one's tricky. We've got this function. We need to find a. And we know we have a local maximum at negative 4. So the very first thing I did was I took the derivative. And so we know that we have a maximum or a minimum when the derivative is 0. And when the derivative is 0, we know this local maximum is negative 4. So I'm going to replace x on the derivative function with negative 4. And I'm going to replace f prime of x with 0. And then the only variable now is a, and I solve for a. Okay. Now that I've got my function, I'm going to replace a with 9. And I'm going to find the coordinates of this local maximum. So I've got my new function. I've replaced a with 9. And we know x is negative 4, so I'm going to replace x with negative 4. And then we figure out our local maximum is negative 4, 1/13. Okay, last question. Okay, the derivative of x cubed plus ax plus b is 3x squared plus a. Okay, we have a stationary point at negative 2, comma 3. So when we've got a stationary point, that means the derivative is 0, and x is going to be negative 2 because of that stationary point. So I'm going to replace x with negative 2. I'm going to replace f prime with 0. And then I can solve for a. Okay, now I've got a. So we're going to use our f of x. And when x is negative 2, y is 3 from this coordinate here. So I'm going to take my original function. I'm replacing f of x with 3. I'm replacing x with negative 2. And we just found out a was negative 12. And the only variable now is b. So we solve for b. Okay, so now we know our derivative function is 3x squared minus 12, because we know that a value is negative 12. Okay, so hence find the position and nature of the stationary points. So if I'm looking at this derivative, 3x squared minus 12, I could factor out the 3, and this is the difference of squares factoring, so we don't know this is x plus 2 and x minus 2. So if I go to my original function and I plug in negative 2 in for x, I end up with 3. If I go to my original function and plug in positive 2 in for x, we end up with negative 29. So we know that negative 2 comma 3 is a local max, and negative and 2 comma negative 29 is a local minimum. You may want to rewatch some parts of this if you need to look at it again.